hard part about playing chicken is knowing when to flinch.
Collision in 400 yards, 350, 300, tap 10.
Right full rudder, 30 degree down angle.
Aye, sir.
This one's gonna be close.
This is a journey into sound. A journey which along the way will bring to you new color, new dimension, new values. And a new experience.
Ultrasound. And now for the conveniers and game show hosts of this session, Lewis Mackin and John Baylitz.
Well, here we are. Well, hello everyone, and welcome to Sonowars 2015. This is our third year of doing Sonowars, which I think you'll agree is probably a smack record, because anything more than 5 minutes old at smack is considered obsolete. But we're back again, and we're delighted to be here, so thank you for attending this afternoon. On my left, the big guy, the guy who's done all the work, is John Baylitz.
Hello, everyone.
He's our local Chicago contact.
Hello.
And he really has done all the heavy lifting for us here in Chicago. But more about John later. So I thought we'd have a moment just to describe what Sonowars is and what Sonowars is not. This is not a college scientific academic session. I don't think I need to repeat that, and that's self-evident. You will not hear the words randomized cluster crossover trial. You may, however, hear frequently the word cluster as you express it under your breath, followed by another word that begins with F. Sonowars is all about ultrasound education with a twist. And to put it in its context, we're just going to take a little quick journey into history here. In 1937, Franklin D. Roosevelt, the 32nd president of the United States and the longest serving president, came here to Chicago to open what's now known as the Lakeshore Drive Bridge, about a mile and a half that way. And this is a very important opening of FDR, because at this time he gave his famous quarantine speech. This is 1937, he could see the dark clouds coming of international politics, and he advocated that the US should not adopt its continued isolationist policy and actually should quarantine those identified aggressor nations. So he came to Chicago. This is a long story, getting to a quick point. FDR was married to a lady called Eleanor Roosevelt, I'm sure everyone has heard of, and in history she's famous for two things. One of those, unfortunately, is that she's well acknowledged as probably being the least attractive first lady in American history. Unfortunately, so much so that even though FDR was in a wheelchair with polio, he managed to have an affair with her private secretary. The second thing that Eleanor Roosevelt was well known for is that she was a very active political woman in her own right, and in fact had a syndicated newspaper column at one stage. And she had many well-known sayings, but her most well-known saying was, "Do one thing every day that scares you." Do one thing every day that scares you. And I can say quite honestly that we are channeling Eleanor Roosevelt very strongly this afternoon. If you saw our meetings only 20 minutes ago, you would understand what I mean. This afternoon, you're going to experience semi-nudity, a lot of music. You're going to experience animal husbandry for a first time in Sonowars, followed by singing. And I strongly hope that the American College of Emergency Physician inspectors who are here to see if SMAC was going to earn any CME credits have now departed the building. But that's enough from me, and you'll hear from John in a moment. Let's meet our faculty.
A toast to a new era.
Go
need me to say.
You never took a quarter from a phone booth. You stole. I just got bigger balls than you.
So, Matt Dawson, Mike Mallin, I think you may have heard of. But this year we thought we'd get some real experts in. And we've got Mike Stone and Vicky Noble also joining us. So welcome on board, guys.
Welcome.
But that wasn't part of the plan. I don't even know what those things you're on are, guys.
So I'll tell you, Liz. We were so inspired by the opening entrance of Roger, Ollie, and Chris that we wanted to reproduce it on a slightly lower budget, American style. Where should we take you?
Now, last year we had the pleasure of seeing a home video of Mike growing up, and you might remember him playing the banjo up in the hills. This time, we've sourced a home video on Matt. So we contacted his folks, and we got this home video, and it's Matt when he's about five, and it's him expressing his displeasure after he's met his babysitter for the first time. So let's have a look at this home video.
She thinks, at the blue, she's a smart little girl, that she can do whatever she wants. No, that's not how she can do it in our family. She's act like she's the queen and we're the sorry people. She's gonna try to stop me, but she can't run those little high heels. Never see this face again.
So Matt, you've come a long way from those days. Delighted that you didn't get in that pickup truck, and thank you for joining us today.
Yeah, I'm not sure where you got that home video footage, but I don't know, thanks. For the introduction.
Yeah. Righto, let's meet the other side. Let's meet the Australians. It's a much low-key Australian approach, as I'm sure you'll appreciate. So you know James Rippey and Andrian Goudie. Now, James was last year voted the Australian Sonologist Tutor of the Year, which was a big deal in Australia. But Andrian, little Andrian Goudie, who would have thought behind that self-effacing demeanour we actually have a political animal? Because Andrian has now just been appointed the Vice President of the World Federation of Ultrasound in Medicine and Biology. So congratulations, Andrian. Oh. So we're going to learn a little bit about where James and Andrian are from. They come from this town called Perth in Western Australia. And we've got a promotional video released by Perth to show it as a sophisticated cultural city. The fluff stops pretty soon, I promise you. I know it's hard. So, ultrasound now, I think you'll all agree, has become a very much an international, global phenomenon. And so we thought today we would break down some institutional barriers. This is smack after all. And one of the barriers we thought we should break down, it's a bit like breaking up the New York Yankees, I acknowledge, is we thought it would be a good idea to separate the ultrasound podcast guys. Now, Matt and Mike weren't too keen on this idea, I have to say. And so they've asked that we have a bit of a competition to see who can really unleash the inner Aussie more so we can have one of those guys join the Down Under team. So we've got a little competition for them.
You got a light, buddy?
Yeah, sure, kid. There you go.
And your wallet.
Nick. Give him your wallet.
What for?
He's got a knife.
That's not a knife. That's a knife.
Righto, boys, front and center. Who's up first?
All right, Australian accent. Let me see here. This is not a knife, man. This is a knife. Yeah? That's right, right? Keep
pretty
that.
Pretty good. So I'm supposed to do an accent. So a few things, Lewis. Number one, I've been told I have an accent. Number two, this is America. We carry guns, not knives. And number three, no Australian is going to come to the US of A and tell me what to do. Am I right? USA. USA. USA.
Right, I'm Michael.
Nobody?
That was easy. All right. We had 25 teams.
To be Australian.
Yeah, you get the T-shirt. Yeah. Welcome to Australia. We had 25 teams come through the Phillips qualifying booth. So thank you so much. The most ever. And it was a lot of competition, but there can only ever be two winners. So can I please introduce our qualifiers? We've got George and Gory from Ottawa, and Magnus and Martin, our ABBA double, from Sweden. Come on, good stage. Okay, welcome aboard, guys. They're going to match up with each of the experts. And then I'm going to now throw to James, and James is actually going to describe the competition as we're doing it.
All right, hello. We're going to have three sections to this afternoon. The first is a quiz, where each of us has put up one or two cases. We're going to cut as time runs out. And the guys that have won the competition or lost the competition, depending on which way you look at it, get to try and answer those questions. So we're going to just go straight into that. Have you got the clicker there so I can advance slides? We'll start off. Why don't you guys sit down there? We've our ring-ins. Come on, grab a seat over here. All you guys come over here. Each of us has got a case, and we're going to just start and run through. Now, I'm going to take this hat off. You know they played that prelim kind of video at the beginning, and you see yourself, and you realize that your voice is an octave higher than you thought, and your head's much shinier, hence the hat. Anyway, we're going to go straight into the cases. We want you guys, you've got a screen there that you could look at, to tell us what you think's going on. This is a case I saw up in where Casey Parker lives, up in Broome. And it's a 50-year-old woman who is short of breath after she's kicked in the chest. And this is her ultrasound. Now, as soon as you see what you think you know what it is, buzz on it and tell me. That's her right chest. Oh yeah! Whew, there was a pause there, wasn't there? All right, what do you reckon?
We don't think there's lung sliding.
Can we get handheld mics out here too, please, Lewis? You don't think there's lung sliding. All right. The key here is that you're right, there isn't any sliding, but you're not actually seeing ribs. Okay? Now, when you look at the chest wall, you should see down to ribs, and then you see pleura underneath. But if you've got a lot of surgical emphysema, you get this white look right from under the skin there. And that patient, Broome's got a very, very easily accessible CT scanner, and the patient went straight to CT. Yeah. So there's a tension pneumothorax. The patient was, they make them tough in Broome, right? The patient's just chatting along, a bit short of breath. So she came back, and there's the rib fracture. You can see it there. Got a chest tube, still lots of surgical emphysema, perked up a little bit. A couple of days later, they cross-clamped the tube, and she went round to x-ray, and she got really short of breath when she went round to x-ray again. Now, Broome is a long way from Perth. And the x-rays get sent to Perth. You know, we've got this IT stuff, so it happens pretty quickly. So the guys who were looking after the patient rang Perth and said, what do you think? And they said, oh, look, there's another tension pneumothorax. Put in another chest tube. And that was the point that I arrived. And I said, well, I'll just have a quick look at. And there's lung markings all the way up there. So I popped an ultrasound probe on this side. All right, get ready to buzz whenever you can. Come on, my guys, do it. Yes, All right, what is it?
Right, it looks like a consolidated lung on the left side.
Okay, and I agree completely. Complete consolidation. You're seeing through the lung. It looks hepatized, but in fact it's collapsed and pulled the mediastinum over instead of being pushed as it was before with the tension pneumothorax. So there was he was an ICU physio there who'd just done medicine. He went and he gave her some great chest physio, and she coughed up a couple of clots of sputum, and within a day that was her chest x-ray, chest tube still in, and then it was out. So ultrasound, amazing. Saved her getting an unnecessary chest tube, bit of physio, and there we are.
All right, those were tough. Those were tough cases. So here's one I want to say to you guys about my two cases. There we go back. Here we go. You seemed a little hesitant to answer there, and I get it, you may be nervous. 2,000 people, you don't want to be wrong. Would it be humiliating to get it wrong for all these people and have retweeted and tweeted? Probably. So I'm going to give you an easy case to get you warmed up. We're all friends here. It's a right upper quadrant of a fast, just positive or negative. All right, you need some low hanging fruit. So just buzz in and say it. Don't be hesitant. Positive or negative? Yeah.
Okay, so that's negative.
Wrong. All right, this is clearly indeterminate. All right, that is an indeterminate scan. Okay,
no.
Who can tell me why it's indeterminate? Don't be shy, we're all friends, like I said. Yes.
You can't see the tip of the liver there.
Perfect. So watch this scan now. It's frozen, now we're scanning. There's nothing there in Morrison's pouch, but as you move up, look at all that free fluid. So we say this 1,000 times, you have to go down to the tip in the right upper quadrant on a fast scan. This is very common. Go down, get that inferior pole. All right, great. So a chance to redeem yourself here. All right, case two. This is a real case, a patient that came in to me, and now we're going to do a rush scan instead of a fast scan. Still a hypotensive patient, but a little different, medical, not trauma. So the guy was sent to us with a UTI, pretty simple. When he arrived...
Matt, I don't reckon your case is next, buddy.
Oh, all right.
You just got too carried away.
All right, sorry.
We're doing 1-1-1-1.
Save it. It's going to be great.
But you're going to know this one. Remember the UTI guy, all right?
All right, so this patient didn't have a UTI. This was a 65-year-old guy who comes in with acute shortness of breath, all right, acutely breathless. You're in the emergency department. The paramedics found him very hypoxic, put him on non-invasive positive pressure and brought him to you. And you look and you take a look at the lung. Hey, Sparky, that's not the question.
But
what do you see
I
there?
I like it.
What do you see?
So you see pleural sliding. You see a lot of lung rockets going off into the far field, so consistent with edema.
Okay, so yeah, B-lines in the right lung. At the right lung base, don't go hitting the buzzers, all right? There's a pleural effusion. Left lung looks like the right lung, right? Left base, what's the diagnosis? It's just a pre-question. What do you guys think this guy has? He's short of breath, he's got B-lines, he's got pleural fluid.
I would really not answer this question without looking at the heart.
Fantastic.
All right.
So incomplete without looking at the heart.
He's teachable.
So we looked at the IVC just because we had nothing better to do, and we saw that. And then we looked at the heart, and that's his apical four chamber. So we'll put some color on there for you. Yeah, go ahead.
So that appears to be a clot in the right atrium.
Okay, so it's a good guess in that it's an atrial structure. But this side, this is the left atrium. And we've got this prolapsing through the mitral valve into the left ventricle. Hard to form a clot there. So what do you do for this person? He's short of breath, he's got decompensated heart failure, and yet he's not filling his left ventricle. And this patient needed fluids, despite being in decompensated heart failure and an emergent surgery. So this patient went straight to the operating room where they took that out. And this was a case of a primary left atrial myxoma presenting as acute decompensated heart failure. You're not gonna see that much, but whether it's valvular disease, right? You are gonna see flail mitral leaflets. You are gonna see other structural heart disease, aortic stenosis, that presents as acute heart failure. And your answer definitely wins for me because taking a look at the lungs, it's great, sorry, Vicky, but if it's bilateral pulmonary, you know, B-line pattern, and you think it's pulmonary edema, you gotta look at the heart and see what's happening with the heart because this may be a surgical case and not a medical case. All right, good job, guys. Yeah. Who's next? Oh, that's just for gratuitous cardiac MRI. We can skip that.
Adrian.
Okay. This is a man, he's an elderly guy, and he's got severe epigastric pain radiating through to his back. Yep, what do we think?
Aortic dissection.
Okay, it certainly looks a little bit like that. Let's see what the next one we've got. We've put some colour on it, looks similar. Let's move to the next one. Now with this, I'm just sliding the probe a little bit from one side to the other. Anybody got any other comments? Do you still think it's a dissection? Okay, it's a little tricky. As the probe moves from one side to the other, it almost looks like you're looking through the lens of a set of glasses that you're lifting up and down. It's sort of like a double image. And in fact, the rectus muscles are the shape of lenses. They can bend the ultrasound beam, and sometimes one of the beams will go straight through, but the other will get bent through the rectus muscle. And so this is actually all artifact. This is a normal aorta. There is no dissection there at all. Okay.
Wasn't it Cliff Reed that said the aorta will fuck you up? Don't let that one go to theatre.
This has been brutal, huh? These guys are like hitting you with some really tough stuff. I mean, like, this is nuts. Let's try something a little bit easier. So you're working in the clinic or the emergency department or even critical care, and you got a guy that comes in with flank pain, and it looks everything like a kidney stone. So you want to take a look at the kidneys, right? So what do you think? All right.
So we don't see any hydronephrosis there?
Right, yeah, there's no hydronephrosis there. So are you done? You're just gonna discharge this patient? Is there anything else you wanna do? Yes, sir.
What does his abdominal aorta look like?
Oh, it looks fine. You looked at it too. It looks good. You actually have a CT scan on him from a month ago, and it was totally normal. Anything else?
Gallbladder?
Gallbladder's fine. Some right-sided flank pain. Want to take a look at any other urinary structures, maybe? Like the bladder, right? Let's take a look at the bladder. What's the bladder look like? See anything funky? Yes, sir.
So it looks like there's a stone in the bladder now.
Yeah, what are we going to do to decide if that's a stone or not?
Look at it. Look for echo, like shadows behind it.
Yeah, and put color flow on.
Put some color on, look for some jets.
Nice. So this is called twinkle artifact. Nothing's crazy about this, nothing's scary. This is a really cool trick that we can do when you think somebody has a kidney stone, but you don't see any hydronephrosis. Not every patient with a kidney stone is going to have a backup of fluid in their kidney, especially if you catch it early. Most patients in the States are so weak, they come in within 15 minutes after their pain. In Australia, you know, where we live, it's amazing because people will stay for like 4 days in Broome, right, before they even come in, and their kidneys exploded already, and they've got a positive fast. So this is a unique situation. So Australian docs, you don't need to worry about this, but for Americans, you need to consider this because people come in so quickly with their pain that you definitely need to put some color flow on the UVJ because you can easily get a stone in there and diagnose it really quickly. Good job, guys.
Here's
the green button.
The arrow.
Okay, so we all know why I'm here, because I'm here to be the mother of the group. but we have a case here, non-trauma abdominal pain, looks unwell, and you guys are going to tell me whether this is positive or negative. All right, what do you think?
I think it's largely an adequate view, but from what I can tell, there's no free fluid.
There's no free fluid. What do you guys think, Sweden?
Hey, can we just kill the music, the Jeopardy music?
This is tricky. Let me show you the next clip. And the hint here is right here. Yeah, what do you think?
Well, possibly it's an organized hematoma.
So remember when when you're looking for a positive fast, not everything is going to be anechoic and free fluid. And there's lots of things that can happen in the abdomen that can be, you know, catastrophes that will look like heterogeneous and mixed material. So this person, here is right here, the spleen, and there's all this fluid that looks really sparkly and heterogeneous above. And so they had actually ruptured bowel and had all bowel contents spilling through their abdomen. And if you look back at this other one right here, and you play this, whoops, play this clip, sorry. If you look really carefully right here, do you guys see this sliding back and forth here? It's almost like that pulsistalsis, do you know that term? When you smush on an abscess and you see the pus move back and forth. And so what's happening here is that the fluid right there is heterogeneous because that's bowel contents, and so it's moving back and forth. So that's a hard one, I'll grant you, but that you have to be careful when you're looking at the abdomen because, you know, she's really tender, she was hypotensive, and this is a surgical emergency. The other thing you can do is you can look here, and what do you guys think about this? Remember, we're looking at her abdomen, and you already know the answer. Yeah? What do you guys think?
I'd take a wild guess and say that it's gas in the abdomen, that it's outside the bowels.
Exactly. And what we're doing here is it almost looks like a curtain sign, and that's because you push with the probe, and you push the free air away, and you can see through it to the abdomen, and then when you let go, the free air goes to the top, and when you push, the free air goes away, and when you let go, the free air goes to the top. So again, you know, air in the abdomen is going to look just like air in the lungs with the horizontal A-lines, and so you just have to be really careful. This is another picture of the same thing using the linear probe, and again, when you push, you kind of push that free air out of the way, and then you can see through to the bowel in the abdomen. So that's, again, a tricky one, but, you know, it is SMAC. So. And then this is the CT. And you can see FAST is not just for trauma. You can see there's bowel contents here in the abdomen. Echogenic debris can be blood, pus, or anything really. And air it will look like air, and it will have those horizontal A lines, and you can push it out of the way when you're looking with your abdominal probe. Okay.
All right, now we had a long, well done. We had a long intro, and so, We were going to have 12 cases where we put you all through this, but we're going to just zip through them because there's a lot of fun stuff and silly stuff to happen. So 15-week pregnant woman comes in urinary retention. I'm just going to tell you, big full bladder, feiny looking uterus, and this is called an incarcerated uterus, which I know my team would have got and these guys would have struggled with. But what happens is this is an antiverted uterus. It's amazing. Medicine is so cool. You learn something new every day. This is a retroverted uterus, all right? And if ultrasound looked like that, it would be even better, wouldn't it? So as you're pregnant and it gets bigger, sometimes the uterus gets stuck, retroverted. And it gets bigger and bigger like that, and it's not happy. And that, at that stage, causes urinary retention. Patient comes in really unhappy, about 15 weeks usually. You put a catheter in. So this is what it looks like, and here's that ultrasound, and in fact you can see there is the cervix, and this little baby's being squished backwards. This is the sacrum in here, and that bladder is really full, all right? And you empty the bladder, and sometimes that does it, but sometimes you need to pull that and push that, and you end up with a happy baby. All right? Zip through them.
All right,
you do
so
it
you've
yourself.
Been desperate for this UTI case. So when it arrives, it's actually a little more than a UTI. Patient is altered, they're hypotensive, they're uroseptic. So we intubate the patient. We already know what their source is. We source control, we start them on antibiotics, we call the ICU, we start resuscitating them. I had an ICU fellow with me that wanted to do a rush exam. They wanted to learn how to do it in practice. So I said, sure, go ahead and do it. We already know what's going on though. So they took a look at the heart. It was pretty normal to hyperdynamic heart, what we would expect. Take a look at the IVC and we struggle a little bit. What do you guys see there? Interpret that for me. So I'll interpret it for you since we're running a little behind. So you see the free fluid right there. So we saw that and immediately thought, what is going on there? So we scan through a little more, try to investigate. We're sagittal at this point. We slide side to side. We see some sort of strange mass right there. And then we take another look at it, sliding over a little more in that right upper quadrant, slide back and forth right on the liver edge, right where the gallbladder normally sits. What do you think that is? What's your diagnosis? Right where the gallbladder normally sits. Hint. It. It's a disgusting gallbladder. So this is the source. It's not the urine. This is the source. We admitted the guy, he needed source control going to the OR, not just antibiotics. The ICU attending came down the next day and told me, look, this guy would have died for sure if you hadn't done this rush scan on him. We would have admitted him. He was already on antibiotics. We've given him fluid. We would have slowly turned his pressures up as his blood pressure went down until he coded. So now when I'm rushing an elderly patient, like a Rippey or Goudie age type patient, I always take a look at that right upper quadrant just to make sure that I don't have this. It's usually not going to be helpful, but you may get lucky and may save a life. Who's next?
All right.
We're just going.
So we knew we'd get behind, so we're consolidating a case. So 46-year-old male, syncopized, complains of chest pain, and the resident comes out and tells you that they think the machine's broken while they're trying to do an echo. So your choices are that the machine's broken or that something else is happening. Yeah.
Something else is happening.
Fantastic. I knew you were going to get this right. Way to go.
Team
awesome.
USA.
Team America. All right. So, you know, this was odd. And whenever you see something odd and your view just disappears, you got to think about whether it's air. So we took a look at this gentleman's lungs. And this is something called a double lung point sign, where he's got pleura up there, lung sliding there. And then pay attention down here. There's diaphragm. But see how it's down there. All right, so this gentleman went ahead, had a CT scan done, and what was happening with him with that echo is that as the heart was filling in diastole, it was making contact with the chest wall, and you could see it, and then as soon as it contracted, it fell away, and the air slipped in, and you lost your whole view. So if you're really ever getting tripped up around the heart, think about air. And along that line, we'll see if this goes for you, Vicky.
All right, so what do you guys think, positive or negative for pneumothorax? Yeah?
Depends where you're looking.
Oh, I love you. All right. So, yes, very good. Because remember, when you're looking for a pneumothorax, I think my next slide is this, is the visceral and pleural pleura should be on the same plane, right? So when you're looking, as the pleura moves in and out at that lung point, they should be in the same plane and should be at the same line. When you're looking at this clip on the right here, hopefully, yeah, it moves in and out, but the reason it moves in and out is because you're a little bit too low. And so this lung point down here is actually the diaphragm, and you're a little bit too low. And the trick here is when you have a trauma patient or somebody who's having pain, they don't take deep breaths, and so the diaphragm can creep up pretty high. And you have to be really cognizant that that lung point should be at the same depth or the same deepness, because if you're seeing them at slightly different levels, you have to worry that maybe that's the diaphragm moving in and out of your probe and out of your plane of view. So that's a very tricky one, but it's a common false positive. There's nothing that mimics lung sliding. So when you see the sliding, you know that the lung is moving, but you just have to make sure that you know kind of where you are in the chest. So good job.
All right, what we're going to do is we're going to skip straight on to the next teaching session. So the first session is just to make us all relax a little bit and kind of show you some cases, show you what we do every day. And where ultrasound can get you and sometimes challenge some others. The next session, we've got three little vignettes of ultrasound teaching aimed at the general population. And it's to show how we teach as much as to teach you something. And if we can have a slide, I think we're going to go to the teaching competition. I'm going to go first. And I've got not very long now. And I'm just going to show you what I do. When I start teaching IV access, all right, and the first thing I do with people who haven't done a lot of ultrasound before is I show them what water looks like. This is a bucket, and it's got water in it, all right? And you don't see a lot, all right? Not very useful. But then we're going to put some, I might get someone to come and adjust the machine for me. One of you guys. Depth, please. 6 centimeters or deeper. All right. So this is Metamucil, psyllium husk, okay? It's good for lots of things. And I'm going to put a bit in there, all right? And we're going to stir it around and see what happens. This is why ultrasound is such fun. You should see when I get to the jelly, all right? Up the gain a bit. All right, so now this is what liver looks like. You've got lots of little bits in it, all right? It smells great, too. All right, we might go curvilinear if we could. All right, so I've turned water into liver, changed the depth a bit deeper, give me a bit more string. string. You see, I'm so technical. Gain up at the top. All right. Then I show them, this is a glove full of water, okay? And I show them what veins look like and what water looks like, how it's black. You can see the back of it. You can go in transverse and you can go in longitudinal. All right? So there is water. Then we're going to go a bit of metal. Change my depth, please, shallower, 6 centimeters. And then we look at metal. This is a fork, all right? And so they know that metal looks, when you get it in longitudinal like that, when you get it in transverse like that. And we play around like that. Sometimes I show them what air looks like. And you all do this for kids and draw little chicken things, don't you? Well, I put that underneath. Oh, have you seen the shark? Doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo. I like that, yeah? They like that. And the elephant, this is the last one, I promise, and then I'll get back to seriousness. All right, the elephant, I think, is great. You tie these two together. All right, someone should do a blog on this. All right, we've got the shark. Now we've got the elephant. Can you see that there? You've got to just draw eyes, and we've got the chicken as well. All right, if you've got more, put it on a blog or tweet it, and we'll see it. That's cool. All right, sorry. just slightly distracted. All right. Then I show them what air looks like. I let them play with their fingers. Bone, how about a rib? You use a tongue depressor, put that in. All right, looks like that. All right, so now we're on to the next section. Then what I do is I get them to make vessels, all right, and make phantoms. We get a simple chicken breast.
You're going to drop the probe.
You hold the probes. You're helping me here, Vicky. I won't be popular. All right, you get a chicken breast, you put it down on some cling film, you get some balloons, modeling balloons. You try and get chicken that's not off, but you know, do the best we can. And you just roll it up like that, small breast, like that, small. Now, if you want a really, really small vessel, like a radial artery, here we go. We've got tubing, we've got a big stick. We're just gonna put the stick through the chicken. All right, we're gonna go through here. We're gonna pull it out the other side, carefully threading that through, okay? Then undo that. You put colour into one side. I got the tremors because, you know, I'm allowed to. There's 2,000 people here. And you squirt your red stuff in there. You clamp both ends and you end up with something that looks like this, okay? And that's a radial artery. If you want an internal jugular, so those small vessels are more like basilic, IJ and carotid. We're going to get two of these, put them together. We're going to lay them on the chicken here, and we're going to wrap them up and put that over like that. Okay. All right. Can we get the string down, please? All right. And Mike's going to have a look at those in a minute and see if they actually look anything like vessels, because we're in trouble if they don't. Let's put that back on there. We get the string down, and we can bring on the probe, please. Can't get good help these days, can you? They're coming on. All right. So I always take with me a giant ultrasound probe. It's very useful for teaching. They don't like it on planes. How do I do this? Someone know how to do this?
Twist back.
And back. Thank you. There we are. There we go. All right. We're going to go up. Okay. We've got a haze machine. All right. And do we have a needle? Okay, come on in. All right. I also always take a Yoda suit with me. Come on, Mr. Jedi. And the first thing I want to show you is about in-plane, okay? You've got to be thinking about this ultrasound beam coming down here as a slice and getting your vessel. Can we mimic this, please, on here?
If you didn't give me these pygmy gloves, I could help you.
We'll use this one, okay? Right. See what it looks like. They're going to be deep vessels. Put it on. We're going to up the gain at the back. Depth down. Okay. Look at that. IJ carotid, okay? If you want, you could put more pressure in the carotid and less in the IJ balloon, and then it squishes better. All right, can you get a longitudinal and get it in line, please? All right. So we'll start like this, okay? And like that, and come around here, sir. All right, so in plane, I want the hole on top. Okay. Everything is in line, okay? And you can see, have we got it on ultrasound beam? We got the needle coming in. All right, Adrian, I'm going to get you to stand at the other end because it's got a match. Yep. Going to come around here and you're going to do it from there. We'll get the ultrasound coming in, the needle. Mike Stone. All right. And you slowly bring it in. But the thing to remember is beam width. Now we'll turn to here. Slice thickness, they call it. The most important thing is we all think that this is a super thin beam, but it's not. It actually is a little bit wide, okay? And when you put this down, if it's here on the side, can we get a picture from the front camera? So I want to be looking up this like this, and in here, that's great. So if you're, I'll just hold that for a sec. If that is on the side like that, it's still in the ultrasound beam, and you still see it on your picture. So what I do as I'm going in is I get halfway down, and then I move the needle from side to side. And when it's in exactly the middle of the beam, it's as bright as it can possibly be. So move to the left, Adrian and Mike, and you see that needle gets paler on the screen. And now move across to the middle, and right to the other side. Keep going, Mike. Yep, and so you lose your needle and then back into the middle. And when it is at its complete brightness, that means it's in the middle of the beam, okay? Now, go for it. You can enter. You're gonna go, you see that tenting, and you pop through, your needle goes in, and you've popped into your vein. So the key bit of teaching there is about slice thickness in plane. All right, we're just very quickly going to go to out of plane. We're going to go there. We're going to keep that like this, all right? We're going to turn this around so your hole's a bit further away. Okay, you can see our courses are crazy. So out of plane, the key then is to think that you've got a thin beam here and a picture of the tip of the needle looks just the same as a picture of the base of the needle. So the key, if you hold your probe still, okay? So the key when you're doing out of plane, we can stop Hayes now, that's great, thanks. Can anyone see me? I can't see anything. So when you're out of plane, the key then is to start even higher, I'll just grab it. Adrian can't see. He's doing pretty well for someone who's got a mask on that can't see. You're gonna start, you're going under the skin, and then you're gonna move the probe and you're gonna find the tip of the needle. And then you're gonna move the probe away till you lose the tip of the needle, and you're gonna advance the needle till you see the tip. Okay, and you can always jiggle the needle a bit to make it more obvious. And then you're gonna lose the tip, and then advance, and you're gonna move forward, lose the tip, advance, and you should be on the vessel now, beautiful. Just jiggle a little bit, make sure you're there, that's good. And you're gonna go in, pop it, and there's your tip in the vessel. So follow the tip, lose the tip, follow the tip, lose the tip. IV access, skit done. Well done. Thank you. Let's go down with this. Thank you.
All right. So do we have any fans here of nerve blocks, body painting, or learning? Any of those three? All right, great. So all three awesome, but even better and even more cool when you combine them. So what we're going to do is we're going to teach you nerve block innervation distribution through body painting. All right? So here's how we're going to do it. We're going to show you an injury like this, or we're going to show you a radiograph like this. You're going to identify the pathology. This is a boxer's fracture. And then once I show you this, you're going to yell out what nerve block you would do to treat that. So anybody? All are great. So then what's going to happen if we can get our model to come out? Vicky is going to body paint this model where that innervation is. And Mike is going to give you his best tip for how to be successful with that block. So we got our model coming. Come on, come on, he's got his paint. Great, great. Let's put this on you. There we go, look good. Perfect. And so we've got your brush up. So I just heard that our model actually is allergic to paintbrushes. So Vicky's gonna use her hands. We shouldn't need this. So we're gonna just start before anybody changes their mind. First injury. If you're a Cleveland Cavaliers fan, you're not gonna like this. You may wanna look away. So what is this injury that's happening right here? Oh, so if you don't know, if you don't follow the NBA, this is a shoulder dislocation. So what nerve block? I heard one person somewhere say interscalene. Perfect. So Vicky, interscalene distribution.
All right, and in the meantime, while you're looking for the interscalene nerves, the thing you want to do is just go lateral to the border of the sternocleidomastoid. So you can see SCM up here, and then right here, C5, C6, C7. If you can't really make out the anterior scalene or the middle scalene here, you can have the patient sniff, and they'll come up towards the top of the screen. Okay. The things that you have to do to get this right, you got to go deep to the prevertebral fascia, which is right there. And you also need to end up going, making sure that you don't have any blood vessels in the way. So right here, I don't know if you guys are seeing my screen or not, but right there, that pulsatile thing, that's the transverse cervical artery. We want to stay away from that.
If we can make the left side just the ultrasound screen, that'd be great. So we'll move on to the next one and then we'll get this one.
Yep.
So because we're kind of late on time. So interscalene block also great a little lower down. So you have an injury like this. Oh, sorry. So humerus fracture is going to be great for treating that pain. So now another very subtle injury there. Distal tip fib. Sorry about that. What are you going to do to block this? What's your nerve block?
It's in the leg.
It's in the leg. Hint. What's that? Sciatic. Great. I didn't hear anybody say it, but we'll pretend you did. Great. Sciatic. So Vicky's going to do the sciatic distribution. Mike, what's your best tip when doing the sciatic block?
Well, the tip to the sciatic block is you got to find the vessels in the popliteal fossa, which I can't say I often do while leaning over and doing it on myself, or you know, maybe I do. But right there, we're used to looking for the vessels, and the tibial nerve's right on top of the popliteal vein. So that's tibial nerve, and as you slide up the leg, it's going to come together with the common peroneal nerve to form the sciatic, which is right there. So my biggest tip there is just go just distal to the bifurcation, where those two nerves share a sheath, which you can kind of see right there, and then just pop right in between the two of them, and give them about 15 or 20 mLs of local anesthetic.
Great. So next injury, you're on the street of Chicago, you're just minding your own business, watching this guy do his thing, and it kind of goes horribly wrong right about there. So he has this fracture. All right, you've got over your nausea that you just had just then. Now what's the nerve block? Give me a nerve block that's going to work for this. So I heard a few different ones, which is great. There's a little bit of crossover with this innervation, especially when we're talking about the brachial plexus. The one we're going to show you, because we like it, is the supraclavicular.
All right, so just above the clavicle, and you've got the subclavian artery. You've got the brachial plexus just here lateral to it. Down here is pleura, so you obviously want to stay away from that. And one tip I can give you is right here, you're going to be coming in from the right of the screen posteriorly. So if you're looking, you don't really have much in the way here. You could go right under the rib and into pleura. So if you take the lateral edge of the transducer and just rotate it posteriorly, you can bring the first rib down as a backstop. And then you can come in from lateral to medial, go ahead and start right here and just inject and get a good supraclavicular block. Obviously, you got to put color on for this too. Make sure none of those other dark spots are vascular. And a good 20 mLs here is usually plenty.
Perfect. Guy feels better. Next patient is this one. Just to orient you, this is an abscess. Yes, those are pubes right there. So what would the block be? Heard somebody say it, a tap block. Great. This is how you do it.
All right, so you're between the costal margin and the iliac crest, and what you're looking for is sub-Q tissue followed by external oblique, internal oblique, transversus abdominis, and then peritoneum. And you're going to go from anteriorly to posteriorly, and you're going to put the needle right here on that plane between the two. If you inject and the muscle swells, then you're not really in the right plane. Those two planes should just separate and let the anesthetic spread in there. The one tip I'd give you is don't go too far posteriorly, because you can see that plane ends near the back. So make sure you're starting anteriorly enough that you can get into that plane.
Great. Abscess feels better. You drain it pain-free, patient happy. Now it's Saturday, you're at a football game, you're watching, having a good time, and then that happens. So you happen to be there, you've got your new tablet ultrasound device, you go down on the field, do a block on the field at the 50-yard line. This is the injury. How are you going to block that? What's the block? Femoral nerve block, or fascioiliacal block, I heard somebody say. Great.
Just give me a second. All right, hold on. We're going to get there. There we go. So what you're going to look for is the femoral artery. And then just to the side of the femoral artery, you're going to find the femoral nerve, which is right here. And if you slide just even more laterally a bit from there, down here is femur, and up here is fascia iliaca. And you just need to get deep to that that fascial plane. It doesn't really matter if you're kind of out here, more like a traditional fascia iliaca block, or if you're over here a bit more closer to the femoral nerve, it's going to end up getting you a good block either way. So just make sure you get through that fascia and you're above the iliacus muscle, but not above the fascia itself.
Okay, the last block is for an injury that could happen or a very common procedure that you do. And when I'm going to show you this procedure, you're going to say, why would I ever do that? Well, because it hurts to jab a needle around in someone's neck, and why not get the patient pain-free? If you're going to be injecting a little bit of lidocaine, why not go to a half centimeter deeper and actually do a nerve block, make them completely numb? You could also do this for an injury like this. And what block am I talking about? SCP, superficial cervical plexus block.
All right, this one's really easy, and you can do this blindly, meaning with anatomic landmarks and not with ultrasound. If you do it that way, you find the mastoid and the clavicle. You go midway between those two points at the posterior border of the clavicular head of the sternocleidomastoid. But if you're going with ultrasound, it just kind of makes things a little easier to see. And if you do that, you'll see in the near field the sternocleidomastoid, and then the muscles, whether they're scalenes or levator, depending on where you are, in between. And you're just going to put a needle in between in that plane where the nerves live. You may not even see the nerves in there. They're pretty small. And the one thing to keep in mind there is, as opposed to the inner scalene, which is down here where you want to be through the prevertebral fascia, for this block, you want to be above it and just in that space. And typically, just about 10 mLs of local anesthetic will do it right.
Great. Thanks, Mike. So let's see how Vicky's been doing. Pretty horribly. Luckily, we've seen Vicky do body painting plenty of time. We knew it was not going to turn out great, so we pre-painted someone. If we can have our pre-painted model come out, Dr. Taryn Trott. Dr. Trott, Taryn, here he comes. Great. And we've got a key for you here. So I told you we were going to give you a deliverable. So Taryn, kind of stand underneath this right over here. So you can take pictures of this. Put your arms out. Show them your distributions. And what we're going to do is we're going to take some 360-degree photos of Taryn later, make a nice little product that we can send to you, and you can quick reference that. So let's give a hand for our models, especially Taryn. Taryn, don't go up. I sent Taryn this text message yesterday, and for some reason he showed up at my room after I sent him this. So I want to thank Taryn. He's a trooper, and ladies, he's also single and relatively VD-free, so hit him up. Taryn, thank you, and you're welcome.
All right, we can go to just the keynote. Eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one. Restart compressions. 10 seconds. That's how much time you have to put an ultrasound on a patient's heart in the middle of a cardiac arrest and potentially make a life-changing diagnosis. 10 seconds is how long Rob Bryant had to get an image like this one on a patient that he had suspected a pulmonary embolus. Rob used this image to decide to push TPA on an arresting patient. And after that, he decided to send that patient over to get a thrombectomy. That patient walked out of the hospital. 10 seconds is how long Sam Galli had to get an image like this one on a patient that came in with a V-fib arrest. Sam used this image to decide to actually give the patient lytics, even though he works in a hospital that has a cath lab, because he couldn't stabilize him enough to get him upstairs. 10 seconds. It's how much time you have to recognize ventricular fibrillation when you miss it on the monitor. 10 seconds is how long you have to recognize an LAD lesion. 10 seconds is how long you have to recognize that you need to do a pericardiocentesis. 10 seconds is a lifetime, or
It could be someone else's lifetime. The problem is, when we perform ultrasound in reality, it looks more like this than the images that I just showed you. And my guess is you guys have seen images like this in the past, and you've recognized that maybe it's a little bit harder than we all tell you. Maybe every model doesn't look quite like this. And the problem becomes, how do I get that image in under 10 seconds? Because in reality, it's going to take longer than that. And if it does, you might be killing your patients. This is a graph that shows what happens to the coronary perfusion pressure when we take too many interruptions during CPR, when we take too long during our pulse check. We've got this interesting dichotomy in ultrasound, especially in cardiac arrest, where we have the potential to improve our patient's outcome with ultrasound, yet we also have the potential to make it a lot worse and actually kill our patients. So it's kind of weird to me that we don't actually practice this. We don't talk about how to get these images fast so that we're helping our patients and not killing our patients, right? So let's do that. Let's talk about it. First thing is, you've lost the parasternal windows. Don't even try to get them, because if you're going to get them, you're going to have to wait for the CPR provider to move their hands first. Instead, use the apical or the subcostal. You can actually get these while the patient is getting CPR. You can start to get the window so that when you stop CPR, you can actually see the heart right then and there. You've got it already. So I think probably the best way to do this is to sort of show it. So Vicky, Mike, will you guys come help me out here? I'd like to show how we're actually going to get these images in CPR. Can I have a model, please?
We're doing this one or this one?
So why don't we do this one right here? And then, Mike, if you'll do, Mike, why don't you do CPR for me? And Vicky, if you don't mind doing the ultrasound. So Vicky, what I'd like for you to do is I'd like for you to demonstrate the worst possible code you can imagine using cardiac ultrasound. Why don't I give you a little bit of music?
Start compressions. Hold compressions.
Oh, this is terrible. All right, what are you looking at, Vicky?
The lung pulse.
All right, done. Mike Stone, take over. Do some echo. Vicky, why don't you do the compressions for me? I'll have you know Vicky had to actually find a stethoscope for this because she doesn't own one, and she didn't know what one was at first when I asked her to grab one.
What?
All right, so let's take this into the 2010s here. So, Mike Stone, why don't you get us an apical window while Vicky's doing compressions on this patient? Believe some dead, resuscitate him in the street, serve him breakfast in bed. That's not bad, that's not bad. Can I get the keynote back up real quick? So here's what I want to talk about. So there's one particular problem that happens whenever you're trying to get an apical window in a patient, and this is extremely common. And what happens is the beam actually comes out of the probe in the center of the probe, right? So it's not coming out of the entire footprint of the probe, just the very center of it. So if you imagine, if you take that square probe and you try to put it in between ribs, what's going to happen is the beam is going to come out of the probe and hit the superior rib. Because it's just natural that the probe's going to sort of fall into the inner space. So you have to do something very non-intuitive whenever you're trying to get an apical window, not just in cardiac arrest, but any time. And that's actually pull down on the probe so that you allow the beam to go through the inner space as opposed to hit that superior rib. Mike, can you just show us that one more time? Perfect. And then let's do some compression so we get an idea of what it looks like. Perfect. This is what it's going to look like, guys. So you're going to get an image just like this. This is an actual cardiac arrest patient, and this is what an apical window can look like. Now, granted, it's not great. You're not really getting much information from it, but you're in the right place so that when you hold compressions during that pulse check, you'll get something like this. And you'll be able to instantly make a diagnosis if there's one to make, whether it's PEA, pseudo-PEA, whether you realize that you need to push lytics, whatever it is. You can also do this subcostal. Here's an example of subcostal CPR, right? Can't really get much information out of it, but you know you're in the right place so that when you stop the CPR, you'll immediately be able to see something. Now, either way, either one of these techniques is going to put you in position to make a diagnosis that could potentially be life-saving. So my recommendation is to you is that you take ultrasound, put it into your cardiac arrest algorithm, and we together can find a way to stop doing CPR like dinosaurs. Thanks.
Okay, can we get the PowerPoint keynote, whatever we've got, up? It is there. Beautiful. All right. So we've had two rounds. We've had a few quiz questions. We've asked a few things. We've had some great little teaching sessions that have made us think a lot about how to teach and hopefully been useful for you. The final, we're allowed 20 minutes till we all get kicked out. Matt and Mike have been up to something. I'm going to do the next thing. And we might skip the last two. We'll see how time's going. But Matt and Mike, you've been talking about what you're going to do. What's the story?
We were really excited when we heard that we actually could make up whatever we wanted in the race, our station. Now, Mike and I love Smack, but one issue we have sometimes, we think that sometimes the hype and the entertainment is so high that you lose the education points. So we wanted to go straight education. No gimmicks whatsoever, so obviously we rented a mechanical bull. That's going to be our station.
So, right, so what's the educational point of the mechanical bull?
Don't look at me, man. This is your idea.
So I convinced them to pay for this. You were supposed to be in charge of the education part.
All right, how about this? How about we do a one-minute fast exam on ourselves, on the bull, and see who can get the most number of fast exams at one time. It'll be like trying to fast a combative patient in an austere environment.
I like that. So in these conferences, a lot of times we show you perfect models. It's easy to get a fast exam, but then when you get back, you've got a drunk, combative patient, or an obese patient, or you're just in an austere environment. What's more austere than a rodeo on a bull? So we're going to show you that you can get these views no matter what your environment.
Yeah. You can actually do an ultrasound. You can do a fast on anybody, any place, anytime. Matt, why don't you start us off?
Luckily, I've got my scanning shirt on. Try not to leave home without it. We've got our windows, the fast scan.
Hey, Matt.
Now I've got...
You want to hand these out to the audience?
Mike saved. It looks like he saved my windows there. I guess we'll get those prizes later. So, I have 60 seconds to get an adequate fast scan.
I'm not sure yet.
As many times as I can. So, John, are you going to kind of moderate? Tell me if I need to go back further, up further, what I need to do here.
Doing the back.
We got any gel?
Oh.
There's some gel. Can somebody grab that gel?
There you go.
Here you go.
Thanks. A little pre-gel.
I could gel you up.
That would be weird. All right, so tell me when my... we probably got a little more time here. Are we good to go? We good to go in here? Okay, 60 seconds. Uh-oh, we're already moving. So, right upper quadrant. What do you think, John?
Got it.
I got it?
Got it.
See the tip of the liver there, go down, you got that? Nice. So, we'll go to the left upper quadrant. This is difficult. Coming back here, a little higher up and further back than normal.
Got
what
work?
Position to have? Nothing, no windows?
Vicky, see if you can get on there and help him out. He needs a hand with that left upper quadrant.
There we go.
No, he's got it?
Got it.
All right, so bladder, I'm gonna go instead of transverse. I'm gonna go sagittal. We want the sagittal window. You like it?
Got it.
Subcostal. Flatten the probe. I'm having trouble. This is harder than it seemed than I imagined.
Almost.
Good enough.
Yep. Yeah. Like it? Good. You get some long sliding. Oh, that's great sliding.
Money.
Great sliding.
Got it.
One down, so we'll keep going. Uh-oh, looks like the bull's going a little faster now. Right upper quadrant, we got it again.
Ooh, got it.
What's the time? It's been a little longer than 60 seconds, hasn't it?
Yeah.
So I got one.
Well done.
Good job.
All right.
Excellent.
Matt, what was that device you were using there?
What's that?
What's that device you've been using on the
bull? What's the cord, mate?
Oh, we've got our new Lumify machine here that we're scanning with. FDA approved for bull riding and rodeos, specifically.
So I forgot my scanning shirt, so I'm just going to have to go bare-chested like Tim Leuenberg here.
Nice job, man.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
All right.
Where's the gel?
Operator, remember this is the Australian team.
All right, let's rock.
That's good.
Is time going?
Start when you're ready.
Oh! Come on, that's beautiful, right?
Huh? Almost.
Almost there.
Can you get a little longer there, Matt?
He needs to come off. Yeah, yeah, you can do it now.
I think your muscles are a bit big.
Yeah.
Oh, he's going.
Oh, we'll give it to you. We'll give it to you.
Brilliant. Through that, Mark.
Dang, do this. Oh, yeah, I'm better now.
He's actually better now. Yay.
All right.
All right.
All right. So, all right. John was carefully taking score there of who stayed on longer and did the best fast scan, so clearly mechanical bull useful. The next is scrotal ultrasound. Can I have my... Now, I'm going to need some models and some props here. Everyone got a bit worried. They thought I was going to do a Leuenberg when I came up here to do scrotal ultrasound, so I've had to reassure people a lot. But I was going to try and do a Leuenberg, but maybe under a sheet or something. But that wasn't on. So 3 days ago, I arrived in Chicago and I walked around looking for inspiration. And just on this corner, we'll zoom in a little bit, in here, was this woman. And I went up to her and I suddenly thought, I can make a strap-on scrotum, right? Which is ultrasoundable. And so she told me the best balloon shop in Chicago, Brody's, just to let you know. And I went out there and I bought over 500 balloons, a lot of Metamucil, a lot of jelly. And I spent a bit of time in my room working out the ideal mixture of Metamucil and gelatin and hot water down through this little thing to make, oh yeah, to make a couple of testes. And then I had to put those inside another balloon. You would not know how hard that is. And add pathology. So can we get our strap-on scrotums here, please? Girls, we have to keep it gender neutral. So girls, up on the beds, please, one each. These are our strap-on scrotums. This is in the name of education. It's proper. It's good. Can I have some ultrasound people to do some scanning? One from each team, and the other's going to interpret. Okay, Dr. Goudie is going to lead you through scrotal scanning. All right, we're going to set these machines up right. We'll get the transducers on. We want dual screens, please. Transducer exam. Ooh, what are we going to go? I can't see testes. How about we just go with that? Yep, superficial it is. All right. Dr. Goudie, all yours. Lead him on. Yep.
Okay. Do you want to help one of these? So, one of the important things to remember here is, number one, be gentle. Number two, warm gel if you can, please. Okay, we don't want to upset our models. Okay, so we start off with longitudinal view of the testis. Okay, just increase your depth there.
So might need to go to curvilinear if there's a problem, because these are Australian testicles, right?
Okay, so we go the longitudinal view, and then we will sweep all the way laterally through the testis, and then all the way medially through the testis. We'll then go transverse, and we go all the way superiorly to all the way inferiorly, so we've seen it all on grayscale. Okay, so now we're going to look at the epididymis, so if you can identify the epididymis. Okay, that's good. So on the left, we can see the epididymis there. If you can rotate onto the epididymis, that'd be great. It's often a little bit tricky. But with that, you can look for epididymal swelling. And as well, we would also then put colour on. So having looked in grayscale, we then put colour on, and we will put colour on both the testis and on the epididymis, looking for lack of flow, which is common in torsion, although the absence doesn't exclude it, and we look for hyperemia. Okay, so if our teams want to have a look up at the screen on the right, we can see that is an image. These are wonderful models, but they're not quite good enough to show the...
Can we get a PowerPoint, the PowerPoint back up?
The PowerPoint back up.
Okay, next, you can click that through, Adrian. All right, so blue team, what do you reckon of your testis? What's the diagnosis there?
Torsion.
They're saying torsion.
Yep, so...
The middle shot, what do you think about the blood flow in there?
On the side?
In the middle one.
Oh, the middle one. Oh, yeah. Looks like good blood flow.
Okay, we've changed our minds, which is good.
Good.
This is good blood flow. You guys get the next one. Adrian, take over.
This is hyperemic, so... This is most likely orchitis, but don't forget torsion, detorsion can also be the same. What about this? If you put the probe on and you see this?
Low flow, possible torsion.
Yeah, so there's no flow within the testis, so that is most likely torsion in the right setting. Do make sure your settings are correct. So the other thing to quickly do, what we like to do, although I don't think we can do it here, is we put the probe on to pick up both testes, and if you see flow in one, then you know your settings are right. No flow in the other, then you're going to start worrying about... Yes. Torsion. Okay, that's it.
It's not quite. I want you to tell me if you saw any other pathology in that scrotum. Sorry. Okay, can you see anything wrong there? I made these. You've got to tell me what's wrong with them.
Okay, first of all, do you normally see that amount of fluid?
Excellent. Here we go. We got something here. You talk into my ear. Oh, Mike. Epididymal head cyst. Oh no! We didn't cheat. Is that what you thought it was?
Yeah, of course it was. To be honest, I have no idea what it's called in English.
That's okay. Say it in your language. It'll sound good.
An epididymal cyst.
I think we got that. Excellent. Epididymal cyst. You guys got any pathology? What do you think?
We said rupture or hydrocele.
Okay, there's definitely a hydrocele there. Excellent. Yep. Go to the bottom of the scrotum. Okay, the other team as well, both scanning. Go up and down.
Yeah.
And go down, down, down.
Right down the bottom.
We're going to go long. You've got a little black. It's very small. You see there's something shadowing there? There, little bright white thing with shadow behind it. What does that make you think of? You guys should, there we go. Bright white thing, shadow behind it at the top. What does that make you think of? A stone, a scrotal pearl. Yes. Now,
as a throwback to Casey, we felt we had to put in a scrotal pearl just to recognise broom and all the wonderful things that come out of there.
And the theory is that you get a little torted hydatid of Morgagni and it falls off, becomes calcified over time, and you get a scrotal pearl. There, testicular ultrasound, you've learned something. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, model. Yeah.
I think there's time for a final rush test between the two groups. All right, so if we can get our final people on. Okay, our final models on. Just the rush. We're not doing procedural. We just need two.
Who's going to do the rush exam? All right.
We need another. Yeah, come on, let's get you on. Here you. We've got a towel here. I'm going to.
Okay, so it's called the rush exam, not the take your time exam, so we're going to go fast.
Okay, lie down here. Excellent.
We don't have very much time here. So I'm going to tell you what to scan. You scan, you get as good of a window as you can get, and then we're going to keep moving.
This is the final race. We're on.
And then we're going to have the audience vote on who got the best images. All right, so you're doing it simultaneously. What's the mnemonic for the rush exam? Contestants, anybody?
High
map. High map, great. Heart, IVC, Morrison's, aorta, and pulmonary. So start with the heart, H, go. Get as many views as you can get in the amount of time that I give you. You've got a nice, you're getting a fair sternum with that curve line of your pro. Very nice. Everybody can see these. You're watching everybody's views, great views. You've got good squeeze on both of those, no pericardial tamponade. So now let's go to the IVC. High map, heart, IVC. So you had an aorta, there you go. IVC, beautiful IVC. What do you think? A little bit of collapsing as she breathes in and out, not a whole lot. Pretty normal. Not completely collapsing. IVC is good. M, Morrison's pouch. So we're going to get
Morrison's. We're also going to take a look at the left upper quadrant if we can as well, on the pelvic, see for any free fluid. Morrison's, get that tip. Remember from earlier the tip on getting the tip. Scan down. Good. Beautiful images. EM, get the left upper quadrant also. The pelvis. Nice. You've got a spleen there. You've got a kidney. On this side, you're going up above the spleen. That's where you're going to see the free fluid. That's where you want to focus. Now get a pelvic view. You're going to go transverse or sagittal. Which would you prefer if you had to pick one? So there's a transverse there. But get a sagittal. Get that sagittal. Make sure you're looking intraperitoneal. Remember, the peritoneum wraps over the dome of the bladder and reflects back. A beautiful view right there. No free fluid. So that's Morrison's A, aorta. Get an aortic scan. Start subxiphoid. Scan all the way through. You're looking for any aneurysm, dissections. Those are pretty good-looking aortas. Now P, pulmonary. We're looking for a pneumothorax. You can see if there's a lot of B lines, any other pathology, but mainly pneumothorax we're looking for here. Good lung sliding on both sides. Great. That was a fast rush. Awesome. So now we're going to vote.
All right, everybody. So what does everybody think? Let's hear some love for the American team. Let's hear it.
America.
Woo!
America.
And what about the Aussies? Let's hear it for them. So who wins?
Sweden!
I like it. Everyone wins. But most importantly, the patient wins with clinical ultrasound. So thank you, everybody. It's been a wonderful, wonderful show.
So thank you. That's Sonowars again for another year. We're just going to finish with a few thank yous in a moment. As you can imagine, this has taken a lot of balloon buying and a lot of people involved on the street. We've had Grace Leo up working the sound. We've had our fantastic sponsors from Philips and their new machine that we saw on the bull today, which I'd like you all to go and see at the Philips stand. We'd like to thank our qualifiers who came along today, and that was George and Gory and Magnus and Martin. Thank you for being good sports with all that. It's not easy. We've had Matt and Mike and Vicky, and of course we've had Adrian again. John Baylitz, he's been the man on the street here. You can imagine we sent him an email saying, yeah, we'd like two ultrasound machines, two couches, one mechanical bull. Ha! And John's answer to all of that was always no problem. So thank you so much, John. And of course, what would Sonowars be without James Rippey? He finds a new way to use Metamucil to muse balloons every year. So thank you, James, for Sonowars.
I think I've heard people say that the greatest thing about teaching is when you see someone that you've taught teaching other people. And I went to Casey Parker's talk yesterday, and I really enjoyed watching that because I've taught Casey some ultrasound, and he's got the passion that I've certainly got for ultrasound. And he finished his talk with a very fitting piece of music, and I'd like him to come up here, and I think we'll all finish with that if we can. We've got a clicker around, and get some people on to help us sing, and you guys can stand up if you feel like it and wave your phones with their torches on once we're on. Can we get the PowerPoint going? Excellent. All right, we've got someone, because I'm not singing into this. We've got someone who can sing.
Where's Casey? Almost.
There we go. And there's Casey Parker. He's the man.
And it might be time for us all to stand up, maybe, because we're celebrating ultrasound today.
Oh, wonderful. Love it.
Come on, guys.
Imagine there's no X-ray.
It's easy if you try.
No CT scanner.
And no MRI.
Imagine all the patients discovered. Nothing left to guesswork.
the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will scan as one. Imagine no request forms. I wonder if brotherhood of sound. Imagine standing in time, talking while you scan. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. Someday you'll join us, and the world will scan as one.
Woo! Nice job.
Thank you, James.
Awesome work.
Thank you for the time. Look at that. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Bravo.
Thank you all.
Thank you and good evening.
Thank you.
Bye.